Hey, Pastor, you in?
You ain't seeing that. Are we there?
Amen.
All right. Deb, I'm having a trouble here. I don't know what I'm doing. Samuel is here, help me. Deb, get ready to do a scripture. Tanya, you get ready for a prayer.
Yes, sir.
Deb, all right, give us a scripture.
I will be coming for Psalm 51. Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy love kindness, according to the multitude of thy tender mercy, blot out my transgression. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgression and my sin ever before me. Against thee and thee only have I sinned, and doing this evil in thy sight, that thou may be justified when thou speakest, and be clear when thou judgest. Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. I read Psalm 51, 1 through the 6th verse, as the Lord has special blessing to the reading of his written word.
Amen.
Let's pray with Sister Tanya.
Lord, we thank you for waking us up this morning and starting us on our way. We thank you for your angels protecting us last night, Lord, and not letting any hurt, harm, or danger come our way. I ask, Lord, a special blessing on the world today, Lord, as we deal with the COVID and now the bad weather. I ask, Lord, that for the ones that have to travel, Lord, that you would protect them and cover them, Lord, cover their vehicle and cover the vehicles that will be around them. I ask, Lord, that you would just continue to touch our hearts, our minds, and our souls, Lord, so that we can reach out to others to spread your undying word, Lord. Lord, I thank you for just loving us, Lord, and keeping us and protecting us and providing for us, Lord, just giving us everything we need. Lord, we know we don't deserve your grace and mercy, but we definitely say thank you. I thank you for my pastor, Lord. I ask that you would continue to bless and keep him, Lord, that you would protect him, Lord, that you would just cover him, Lord, wherever he goes, Lord, and that you would continue to lead him. And as you lead him, Lord, that we would be willing followers, Lord. I ask a special blessing upon each member of our congregation, Lord. Whatever they stand in need of, Lord, I ask it to be your will that you would bless them, Lord. Whatever they're dealing with, Lord, whether it be financial, whether it be mental, whether it be physical, Lord, whether it be the loss of a loved one, Lord, I ask right now that you would just touch their hearts and their minds, Lord, and that you would just be with them and keep them, Lord, and comfort them as only you can, Lord. I ask a special blessing on my mom, Lord. I ask that you could continue to protect her, Lord. I ask a special blessing on my sister as she travels back and forth to work, Lord, and I ask, Lord, that you would bless her and her co-workers and bless the inmates, Lord, that they would be willing recipients, Lord, to obey authority, Lord, that no hurt, harm, or danger would come her way. I ask, Lord, that you would just cover my niece as she travels back and forth, Lord. I ask that you would just touch her mind, Lord, and that you would lead her, Lord, and just provide the way that she needs to go regarding her career path, Lord. Bless her and keep her, Lord, that no hurt, harm, or danger will come her way. I ask, Lord, that you bless my godchildren, Lord, and bless their parents. I ask that you bless my godmothers, Lord. I ask that you touch Sister Brooks right now, Lord, that you would continue to comfort her heart and let her know, Lord, that she's not alone. I ask, Lord, that you would touch Sister Cross, Lord, and bless her husband, Lord, that she would continue to be a helpmate for him, Lord. I ask a special blessing on Sister Gardner and her family, Lord, that you would continue to let her be the woman that you want her to be, Lord. Lord, I ask, Lord, that you would just look in on the world, Lord, looking on the government, the officials, Lord. Let them be of you, Lord. Continue to provide them with the guidance that they need, Lord, so that we can be a world that helps each other, Lord, that loves each other, Lord. Help us not to be backbiting, Lord. Help us not to stab each other in the back, Lord. Help us to give. Help us to forgive, Lord, and just touch our hearts, Lord, so that we can be the people that you want us to be, Lord. I ask, Lord, a special blessing on Mike, Lord. I ask that you would just touch his mind, his body, and his soul, Lord, as he travels for his job, Lord. Protect him while he's on the road, Lord, that no hurt, harm, or danger will come his way. And I ask, Lord, a special blessing on myself, Lord. Touch my body, Lord, as I continue to deal with my health issues, Lord. Just touch me as only you can, Lord. Continue to touch me, Lord, so that I can reach the people that I need to reach, Lord. Touch my mind, Lord, so that I can recall scripture when I need to, Lord. And I just ask, Lord, I just thank you, Lord, for everything that you've done. I thank you for everything that you're doing. And Lord, I thank you in advance for everything that you will do. Lord, this is my prayer in our darling son Jesus' name. Amen, amen, and amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Tanya, for being so kind. And praying for us and our various endeavors. Stan, give us one quick number, and then we're going to move right quickly to where we need to be.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for all that you have done for me.
Amen.
Oh, Lord, the Lord's been good to me, and I just want to thank the Lord for his kindness.
Thank you, Lord.
In spite of my craziness, the Lord was still kind to me. Now, don't y'all look at me and laugh at me like that, because some of y'all have been just as crazy as I have been, if not crazier. Thank the Lord, though, for touching me and giving me another chance. Amen. Isn't the Lord good?
Yes, he is.
Isn't the Lord good? Our lesson for today is one of those lessons that you got to take a little time to kind of try to search it out, where it'll make some sense to you. And I'm certain that some of you have been reading, and you haven't quite got it together yet, of a call to explain. Take a little time to kind of put this lesson together for today, because to me, it has perhaps contents from four chapters, that's yes. Chapter 16, where Paul first is receive a call at night to come over to Macedonia to help us, and he goes there, and there he preaches, and this young lady by the name of Lydia, where he is thrown into jail for preaching. They beat him, throw him in stocks, and then he leaves in chapter 17. He leaves and go into Berea, and from there go to Athens, Greece. And while he's at Athens, Greece, he runs up on all of these, if you allow me to use that terminology, these sophisticated, educated folk who were followers of the so-called philosophy of that particular the day. And then he at Mars Hill, he does not do quite as well as he wished, but he gains a few persons in Athens, Greece, where all these educators are. And it's what it says in verse 34. Howbeit certain men clave unto him, and believed among them was Dionysius the Areopagite, and a woman named Doris, and others with them. And then he leaves from there, and after that he leaves from there, and he goes to Athens, Greece. Leave from Athens, they go to Corinth. And in Corinth, this is where let's want to pick up today, he meets two very devoted, a husband and a wife, by the name of Aquila and Priscilla. When you read the background of this lesson, Aquila and Priscilla were Jewish people who believed perhaps they had been some of those that are known were, had been in Acts chapter 2, when the Holy Ghost came back as a mighty rushing wind, sets every soul on fire. Well, in chapter 1, when Jesus gets the cloud and goes back home to be with his Father, until then, wait until they be endowed with the power from on high. Next, after 2, when they're all together, the Holy Ghost came like as a mighty rushing wind, set every heart on fire. And then Peter preached the sermon, and 3,000 is saved, et cetera, et cetera. And the church began to grow with leaps and bounds. The military and the political center of the first century was Rome, had a significant Jewish population there in Rome. Christianity came to Rome early, likely within a few months after the resurrection of Christ, and then where they preached, you remember the story how they preached and all of them were there. Holy Ghost set on them on the Pentecost. And undoubtedly, they had returned home. Some of them stayed there, some of them had returned home, and they began to spread Christianity into the imperial city. As a result, Christians of both Jewish background coexist with unbelieving Jews in this urban space, jockeying for who see the guru we're going to have the control. Their intentions begin to grow. Gaius, the Emperor Claudius have expelled all of the Jews from the city, whether they were Jews or whether they was Christians or non-Christian. That was roughly in about AD 49. Now, perhaps the Pentecost was perhaps about 35, or between 33 and 35, maybe even earlier than that, probably some 20 plus years now have passed, and they had the Christians are there, and because it's been again this ruckus, then they have to leave from there. These events form the backdrop of Paul's meeting two Jews from Rome, Priscilla and Aquila. He meets them when he goes to Corinth later on, roughly about 51. And during that period of time, the church began to be getting stronger and stronger and more and more. And Paul is trying to have to understand the people to explain to them about this man named Christ Jesus, who they crucified on the cross, who he met in chapters 9 on the road to Damascus, and his lifestyle was changed from there on. Now, our lesson for today, when it says after these things, these are the things that he perhaps is alluding to, chapter 16 and 17, after these things, Paul departs, goes into Athens. When he gets to Athens there, all these educated folk are there. And he does not do, as I said, he does not do as well as he would have liked to have done. So he finally leaves from there. He didn't have the results of planting the church. He was ridiculed by the philosophers of his belief in the resurrection. Oh, yes, and the resurrection. Here we are now some 2,000 years later, and there are still some folk who have a problem with the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It is a fact that he was resurrected from the dead. Point one after he leave from Athens, as I said, in Athens, Greece, where he didn't do as well, Paul leaves there, and then he had left behind when he was in prison, he had left behind Silas and Timothy when he was there. And then they came on to Berea, and finally he told them to make speed and come on to where he was. Now Paul proceeded from where he was to Corinth. It's roughly about 50 miles, Corinth. This city was the seat of Roman government for the area, the residents, and a deputy there by the name of Gallo. Let me back up, if you would, and just read, if you would, for those of us, because somebody perhaps haven't even read the lesson. You don't even know, kind of got to get to what I'm trying to talk about. Chapter 18, verse 1. And I'm going to read why I said after these things, you're going to have to put 16 and 17 together to understand what he's saying by the time he said, after these things, Paul departed from Athens and came to Corinth. Verse 2, and he found a certain Jew named Aquila, born in Pontius, later came from Italy with his wife Priscilla, because that Claudius had commanded all Jews to depart from Rome, and came unto them. And because he was of the same craft, he abode with them, and wrought for work, for by thy occupation, they were tent makers. Jump from verses 3 down to verse 18. I would suggest that you'd read all in between there, because that's a good meeting there. And Paul, after this terrorist there yet a good while. Good while, you'll see later on, he stayed there for 18 months. Then he took his leave of the brethren and sailed thence into Syria, and with him Priscilla and Aquila, having shown his head in Sisera, he had made a vow. Goes back to what the Old Testament scripture was, he made a vow. You didn't cut your hair, and here he had, he finally cut his hair, and it came to Ephesus, and left them there. But he himself entered into the synagogue. That was one of the things he did, like Jesus, the way he went, when he'd find a synagogue, going to the synagogue, and he reasoned with the Jews, trying to get them squared away, went into the synagogue. And verse 20, and when they desired him to tarry longer, he consented not, he left. But Beelzebub was said, I must go. I must, by all means, keep the feast in Pentecost. As you know, Pentecost was one of the festivus days of the Jewish people, where everybody was supposed to go on, especially Pentecost. And after the resurrection of Jesus, now Pentecost has become more, even more important to those who were under to believe in. And Paul was one of those. He wanted to be in Jerusalem for the Pentecost. And if God's will, he said he'll be back. He will be back to see them again, if it's God's will. And they jumped from verse 21, 23, need to be read in between that, and a certain Jew named Apollos. They meet this young man, he was born in Alexandria. He was an elder man, mighty in the scripture, and he came to Ephesus. Oh, that's another story that I'll try to get that. This man was instructed in the way of the Lord, and being fervent in the spirit, he spoke and he told diligently of the things of the Lord Jesus, knowing only about the baptism of John the Baptist. I'll try to get back to that a little bit later on. And he began to speak boldly in the synagogue. Who want to kill him? And Priscilla had heard. They took him unto them. They didn't do like some of us tried to do. He only knew the baptism, or he's preaching the baptism of John the Baptist. So he wanted to explain to him more perfectly the ways of God. No, you can't see it, but jump all the way to chapter 16 of the book of Romans. And he said, a Greek, Priscilla and Aquila, for they was helping with me. Now, I raise that point to say to us, when by the time Paul writes the book of Romans, you can see that he has never been to Rome. He has not been to Rome. He did get to Rome, but at this point, he had never gotten to Rome. He finally got to Rome. When he does get to Rome, you said it's going to be in the end of the book of the chapter of the book of Acts. Who had laid down thy lives, who laid thy lives on our necks, down for the reason of Jesus Christ. Now, let me jump to 2a. Verse 2, chapter 18, verse 2. And found a certain Jew named Aquila, born in Pontus, later from Italy, with his wife Priscilla. Despite Aquila being a Latin name, this man was Jewish. He hailed from the Jewish region of the south shore of the Black Sea, known as Pontus. An era where many Jews, merchants, lived in that particular area. And Aquila had made his way to Italy at some point. Priscilla is the affected nickname of a woman named Phicus. We do not know if she came from a Jewish family, although that is likely, nor do we know if she was from Rome or moved there at another time. Because that Claudius had commanded all of the Jews to depart when they got there, they started kind of keeping up some fuss, and he ran them all off. But because And when Paul gets to to Corinth, he finds these two persons, and because they have the same tree, remember now he's in Athens, Greece. It doesn't do too well in Athens, Greece. When he leaves Athens, Greece, he goes to Corinth, and there he meets with Priscilla and Aquila. Paul joined this couple in a way we have not seen of him at this point, working while in Corinth, indicates that he had worked to support himself. Now, by the time we read in the book of Corinth, Paul talks about the fact that he didn't want people, he didn't want to be held back because the people perhaps didn't want to support him. So he worked for his own living. He, by the time you get to read the book of Corinth, he says that he in chapter 9, turn right quick to chapter 9 of the book of Corinth. I'm just going to 1 Corinthians chapter 9. First Corinthians chapter 9, verse 9. For it is written in the law of Moses, thou shalt not muzzle the mouth of an ox that treadeth out the corn. Does God take care of the oxen? Or saith he altogether for our sake, no doubt this is written, that he who plies should plies in hope, and that he that threshes in hope should be the partaker. If we have sown unto you a spiritual thing, it is a great thing if we shall reap of you carnal thing. If others be partakers of this power over you or not, we would rather. Nevertheless, we have not used this power, but suffered all things, lest we should hinder the gospel. What he's saying doesn't so much. So those of us who went to the armed services, I was working at General before I went to the armed services, but when I went to the armed services, now all of my expenses, in fact, but they gave me a little something up on how, what kind of rank you make. They gave me a little something. I think when I first went in, I was making about a whopping $80 a month plus food and clothing and place to stay. But as I went up in rank, that went up too. But it all depends on. So Paul is really saying, even though he's preaching, he should not have worked to as a tent maker, but to keep people from trying to hinder his work. He worked with he and Aquila and Priscilla, worked as a tent maker so that they would be able to have money for themselves to do what he had to do. Although Paul was trained to be a rabbi by the famous Gamaliel. You remember when Paul had in chapter 7 of the book of Acts, where Paul held the feet of them as they stoned this young man by the name of Stevenson. Then he gets letters from Gamaliel and others to do what he wanted to do, and that was to try to stop the spreading of the gospel. But in the meanwhile, instead of him stopping the gospel, he moved himself from being one that was trying to be destructive to being a preacher of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. A tent maker of this area worked with heavy material. They had to, some of the tents became livable for more than one person. Others, they had just a little small tent. The important part of Paul's willingness to support himself in this matter is seen where he writes to the church several years later. The accommodation that Paul shared with Aquila and Priscilla may have served as a personal lodging or tent factory and sales, et cetera, et cetera. In the language of the church, this verse is the origin of the tradition of tent makers. It's a bivocal ministry in which the church workers receive all a part of thy income from employment outside of the ministry. In this case, Priscilla and Aquila and Paul have an income from the skill that they have and learn how to be a tenth maker and making tenths. We still got that problem today. Verse 18 of chapter 18. And Paul, after this, tarried yet there for a good while. And he took his leave of the brethren and sailed thence to Syria. And Aquila and Priscilla and Aquila. Paul stayed in Corinth, roughly, when you read the text, for about 18 months, about a year and a half, and eventually decided to return to Syria. Initially, Priscilla and Aquila accomplished him leaving their business in Corinth. No other married couple. That's why it's so important that marriage couples, husband and wife, work together in the ministry. I don't know what role, it does not say what role that Priscilla played or what role that Aquila played, but you do see where there were no conflict with them. When a husband and wife together in a couple in the Lord, they need to find out exactly where your position is. That's probably sometimes some women have standard not knowing where their position would be. Did not have a problem with Sister Owen. She was not one of them eloquent speaking person, but her place. And her place was to always bring the kind, more kind and loving. You could see her so kind and loving. And she would do and helping to try to populate the ministry to make it even more stronger than what it was. Thank the Lord for her doing that. He taken his leave, and Luke present this couple in this business ministry. Although Luke does not say they were already in Corinth, but we believe they were already Christian, but they believe that they were Christian because when they get to Corinth, they work with Paul. And then verse 18b, having shown his head in Corinthia, he made a vow. And his vow was he's going to do thus and such and so, and before he would take it, before he cut his hair again. Corinthia is a Corinth port in the east, where it was kind of like they finally back in the 40s, later 40s, they made that, fixed that where the ships and still the ships having to go right around it, come right in there, save a whole bunch of time and money in not doing so. Though he was willing to accomplish his lifestyle to relate to people he encountered in the ministry, Paul continued with his Jewish practice. Wherever he went, one of the first things he did when he got there, he found the synagogue, kind of like Jesus did in Luke chapter 4. He found the synagogue. When he found the synagogue, there they would talk to people about what thus said the Lord. Verse 19. And when he came to Ephesus, and he left them there, but he himself entered into the synagogues and reasoned with the Jews. Ephesus, which means, Ephesus was a city that Paul got in some trouble by, because in Ephesus, they had one of the great gods was the goddess Diana in Ephesus, where women prostituted themselves to be members of the church in Ephesus. And Paul preached against that, and because he preached against that, Alexander the coppersmith and others wanted to hurt him. They began almost an insurrection against him. They would have killed him, but he was able to escape out of there. So Ephesus was one of the largest cities in that area, which is part of what is known now as Turkey. Asia Minor was the third largest city in the Roman Empire at the time of Paul's arrival. Ephesus had a large population with a well-established synagogue. Paul set off a riot in Ephesus in the process of establishing one of the most noteworthy churches in the biblical time. On his third missionary journey, Paul would spend the better part of 3 years there in Ephesus trying to get these folk on the right road. He spent perhaps more time in Ephesus in his ministry than he did in a place in Ephesus. The church in Ephesus was one of the seven churches that the Lord talked to out of the seven churches in chapter one of the book of Revelation. Turn to chapter one, book of chapter two, not chapter two, chapter two, verse one. Chapter two, verse one. Chapter two, verse one. Unto the angel of the churches at Ephesus, angels, pastors. These things said he, these things to the Lord, he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. He said that to them, and he still knows the same thing about us today. I know your works and your labor, patience, and how thou cannot bear them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which they said they are apostles, and are not, and hast found them liars, and abode them, and hast patience, and for my name's sake has thou labored, and have not fainted. Nevertheless, the Lord says, I have something to put against you. And what he got against me is because they have left thy first love. And verse 7, he said, he that has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the church. To him that overcometh, I will give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. You see that in Revelation 20 of the book of them. So Ephesus is one of those churches that he talks about. Verse 20, 21. When thou desired him to tarry longer with them, he consented not. Otherwise, the church wanted him to stay after they were there. He said he couldn't do that, but he bade them farewell. And he says, I must by all means keep the feast in Jerusalem, but I return again unto you if God will. And he sailed to Ephesus. This author, although Paul received a favorable reception in Ephesus, he was in a hurry to get to Jerusalem and to fulfill his vow. This feast likely referred to the Pentecost and most importantly, annual observance of the Jewish people. This would put Paul on a specific timeline and an urgency to return to Jerusalem on time. Passover took a new significance for the Christian because it is associated with the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, most marked up. But apparently, God did not want Paul to return to, apparently God did will Paul to return to Ephesus. And you can see that in chapters 19:1 for just a minute. And after these things, 18 he's there, after these things, Paul departed from Athens and came to Corinth. And then that's where he finds these certain Greek people. And there in 19:1, excuse me, 19:1, excuse me for that. And it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth. Paul, having passed through the up coast, came to Ephesus, and he finally these certain disciples of them. So he is able to return there again. Verse 24, 23 is not there, but verse 24 said, and a certain Jew named Apollos.
19, what? How you get 24?
More than Alexander. Eloquent. Mighty in scripture. Came to Ephesus. He was an elegant speaker, but he didn't have his ducks lined up quite right. He believed strong in the Lord, but he didn't have his ducks lined up quite right. One of his posts was that he preached only, knowing only, the baptism of John the Baptist. Chapter 19 again. Let me go back to chapter 19 again, just for a minute. Turn to chapter 19. And it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus, and he finds certain disciples. And he said unto them, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believe? That's what's wrong with some of us. We say we believe, but we ain't received the Holy Ghost. Amen. And Paul said to them, and they said unto him, receive it. We have not so much as heard what there being the Holy Ghost. A lot of folks today don't know there being the Holy Ghost. And let me just, I'm not going to try to bother nobody but myself. I was around the church for a pretty good little while before I felt the Holy Ghost. I heard my mama talking about it, but I didn't know nothing about the Holy Ghost. Like John talked about it, John 3:3, where he says, marvel not, I say unto thee, you must be born again. Didn't know. But one day it happened to me. And I know the reality of the Holy Ghost. Holy Ghost. And once you get the Holy Ghost, you would be able to stay with and in the divine providence of the Lord, the Holy Ghost. Verse 25. Jump to verse 25. Apollos, known of the way of the Lord, he had made inroads in the famous Jewish school. Producing student like Apollos. He taught the things of the Lord. This reminds us of Paul's synagogue discussion that foreshadows what Apollos did after relocating in Corinth in verse 28 of chapter 18. For he mightily convinced the Jews, and that publicly shown by the scriptures, that Jesus was the Christ. It's important to be able to show people in the scriptures what the Lord said, that Jesus is the Christ. You remember, and turn right quickly to Matthew chapter 28. Chapter 28, Matthew, Mark, verse 17. When Jesus was crucified, for the moment, the apostles thought it was all over. They went home, and the Lord told the sisters to go and get the brother. And verse 17 says, when they saw him, that is a brother now, they worshiped him, but some doubted. And Jesus spake and said unto them, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. And then we have the divine assurance of, lo, I am with you always. How long, Lord? Even unto the end of the world. John the Baptist was a great man, but John the Baptist was not saving anybody. Though Apollos' teaching was done diligently, he did not yet know the full gospel. The baptism of John was a ritual cleaning on the basis of repentance. It did not include the gift of the baptism of the Holy Ghost, something that began on the day of Pentecost. And it says, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all together in one place, on one accord. And suddenly, like as a mighty rushing wind, the Holy Spirit came and it set every heart on fire. And they began to speak in cloven tongues. And that's some of us would say that that's No. They had, Peter was able, they were, each person was able to understand each other in their native tongue. So not don't get that all mixed up. Get that, try to keep that together. They was together, even though they were speaking probably hallelujah, say, but they were the known language. And Apollo began to speak boldly in the synagogue, whom when Aquila and Priscilla had heard him, they knew he was an eloquent speaker, but they also knew his doctoring wasn't quite where it should be. He was talking about John. John was not the one. John even says, I am not he. Don't look for me, but the one that's the Holy Spirit abided upon, that's the one. The Ephesian synagogue had not yet divided on the basis of belief or non-belief in Jesus. Aquila and Priscilla likely were active in the synagogue when they heard Apollos' teaching, realized that his teaching, that his understanding of the Christian message was missing an important component. They met with Aquila privately, not like some of us do. They met him privately to bring him to a better understanding of the whole gospel message. I don't care how well you preach, at some point, you need to talk about the death, the burial, and the resurrection. They said to us, if you haven't did that, when you was teaching and learning how to preach, to write sermon, you had a good message, but you didn't preach the gospel. The gospel is the death, the burial, and the resurrection. The first century connection among preaching about Jesus, baptizing, and the Holy Spirit. Turn to Ephesians 4:4. It says something there to Galatians Ephesians. Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians 4:5-6. There's one body, one spirit, even as there's one calling in your hope, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all, and through all, and in you all. Let me read verse 7. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. It's important that we learn to get together. Name one Lord, one faith, and one baptism. If you miss that, you miss the whole point of what the gospel is all about. To his credit, Apollo accepted this instruction readily and became one of the most influential preachers of the new first century. So much so that by the time you get to chapter 3 of 1 Corinthians, they was having an argument about how eloquent he was. Just turn back one quick thing. Let me just show you that. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Let me just read this. And our brother speaking to you, not speaking to unto spiritual. But as unto carnal, even as babes in Christ. I fed you in milk and not meat. And hitherto you're not able to bear it, neither are you now. For you are yet carnal. Why are you yet carnal? Because there's strife, and I see it in our church, division among us, kind of everybody likes. Pastor, I can't stand you, don't understand. I'm telling you that you ain't quite got over the hurdle yet. Because the Lord already said, way before we get here, in John chapter 13, verse 34 and 35, a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another. And if you don't love folk, you still got strife. There's something wrong with that. You're yet carnal. For while one said, verse 4 said, I am a Paul, and another said, I'm Apollos. Are not you carnal when you start making these kind of decisions? Who then is Paul? And who is Apollos? But ministers by whom we believe, even as the Lord gave to every man. I have planted, Apollos waters, but God gives the increase. We are there as supportive one to the other. Jumps all the way now to laying accolades of the legacy for leaders. Greet, Paul, Romans 16, 3. Greet Priscilla and Aquila. Paul said they were my helpers in Jesus Christ. Thank the Lord for those of you who has been and who are my helpers. We're not here to try to hurt nobody. We're supposed to be here to help one another. Helpers in Lord Jesus Christ. Who for my life laid down thy necks. In other words, they allowed themselves to be in jeopardy to help Paul in his ministry. Unto whom not only I give thanks, but also all of the churches of all of the Gentiles. We learn many things from studying the ministry of Priscilla and Aquila. We see a married couple who worked and ministered as a team. Thank you, Lord. They were not competitive between them, whether they were building tents or building up the people for God. We see a family even willing to relocate wherever God called them, supporting themselves in their original biblical ministry. Their obedience to God will make them cherish companions of Paul. I'm thankful to the Lord for those of you who have been kind to me and trying to help me in this ministry. This coronavirus has been a test in us, if you would. Many of us, when we think we go to the church every Sunday, but the church, that's the building. The church really ought to be in you. And in spite of what happened, you need to do all that you possibly can, that you can lift the name of Jesus where people, maybe they've never been to the church, but they see you. And by seeing you, they will believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Whether single like Paul, or parts of couple like Priscilla and Aquila, All God's people have a responsibility one to another. We must hold fast the profession of our faith and say, like Paul writes, I said Paul writes, in Hebrews 12:1. Wherefore, we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses. Let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that have been set before us, looking unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despised the shame, and now he sat down on the right hand of God. We need to be able to tell this story to other folk. We need to let them know about the goodness of Lord. We need to be partners in Lord, man. We have been called to explain. Now, some who folk don't know nothing about God, but we are called to explain what this might seem to be a difficult situation. We are called to explain to those who perhaps won't ever read the book. They may never read the book, but they will look at you and they will say to you, if you can make it to heaven, living like you can make it, living like you're doing, I can make it too. They miss one point. Those persons who are acting up ain't going, nor are you going to make it into heaven. The record is, only the pure in heart shall see God. Hold on, work on, train on, and one day you will hear the Lord say, well done. Anybody want to hear him say, well done? That's what Paul says. I fought a good fight. I finished my course. And now I see something waiting for me. And I see a crown of righteousness waiting for me over on the other side. Let us repeat the mission pledge. I'm persuaded by the teaching of the Blessed Bible, by daily reading, meditation, and communion with my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, to live an upright Christian life, to practice his teaching in my dealing with my fellow man, to dedicate my talent, to give up my time, influence, and means to teaching or spreading the Christian religion at home and abroad, to win souls through personal service for Christ, to encourage and help in the enlistment of young people in Christian work, and to make my home a center of Christian light and live. To these ends I pledge to devote myself and seek divine aid and guidance daily. For what reason? That I may become a living witness and a bright and shining light for my Lord. Paul, the songwriter, says, let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be accepted in thy sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen.
Amen. Help me.
Everybody say amen. 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 Let me personally thank Brother Stanley. Called me today to see if was I all right. Did I have some gas and lights and water? I was there, and I'm doing pretty good. My water was less for a minute, but I finally got that back on again. So thank the Lord for everything. But somebody perhaps might even be listening who might be having a little problem with you. Let me tell you that, hold on, wait on, God will send help to us. Something I've never had to do before, since I've been in this particular house, is leave the water running on. But I had to leave some water running last night. And I left the water on last night and got up this morning. It was still two degrees. And I turned the water off and went back about an hour later, and the doggone water had froze up. I turned my faucet back on again and left it there. and it cold. It stayed by noon or so. Everybody came on, and by that time, weather be it cold to see whether I'm all right. And I'm taking that on all. Thank you all for each of you who've been so kind. Let me ask her, Weather B, since I mentioned her name, she said she did not get a chance to go to check to see where we are. But let me ask each of us to be kind in your tithes and offering, and send your tithes and offering to New Inspiration Baptist Church, Post Office Box 30702, Shreveport, Louisiana, area code 71103.
Pastor.
Thank you. Yes.
Pastor.
Yes.
I'd like to let everyone know that on the 26th of February, I will be out to the church from 3 to 5:30 to pass out the Lord's Supplement and the Sunday School book.
All right. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, Nico.
You're welcome, Pastor.
Mary Jane, see you now. Hoping Moran is all right. Bless us. Bless us. Let's continue to pray one for the other. And as we do so, God's going to bless us. Tanya, Mike doing you pretty good, baby?
She don't yes, hear sir. Me.
All right, yes, I sir. Thought you didn't hear me. All right, thank you. All right, then.
We love you, boys, Pastor.
Better be good. All right. And then, are you being kind to Shelby? Annette, you being kind to Shelby. I don't see you don't hear me. All right, then. Bless us. Bless us. Thank you so kindly. Thank you so kindly. Thank you again, Brother Stanley. Thank you again. Thank you again. God bless us. Heaven smile upon us. See us Sunday morning, if it's the Lord's will. Oh, yes. Got that text about chances, Mother, because due to the inclemency of the weather, I don't know when they're going to reschedule that, but it has been postponed. That's chances, Mother, who is supposed to be buried today. Bless us. Bless us. Heaven smile upon us.